Thank you, Member, and I recognize the Leader of the Official Opposition.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Honourable Speaker, and it is a great honour for me, as I think it is for all members of the House, to rise at this important moment in the history of British Columbia and speak in a debate on the budget, to talk in a positive sense of where I think the province needs to go, and to discuss, I think, the priorities of the budget, which I think are mistaken. And I say that because I think, Honourable Speaker, all members of this House have a contribution to make. We have different roles as members of the House. Some people are committee chairs, some people are cabinet ministers. There's one premier and a deputy premier, there are leaders, there are critics. But we're all representatives, we're all MLAs, we're all here because of our connection with our community and our desire to represent our community. And I think, for me anyway, in 2005, when I was elected as the MLA for Vancouver Kingsway and took my place in this House, as many members have, I think it was a moving moment for me and a huge responsibility. The people of my community, I think, are extraordinary people, as people of the province are. I think of the students at Windermere Secondary School who work with all the elementary schools in their neighborhood in volunteering programs. They've, I think, defined what a community school is in the city of Vancouver, their involvement in the community. I think of Collingwood Neighborhood House, which is at the center of a community that probably is amongst the most diverse in the entire world, where people work together to create programs, where the community got together. Even though in our absolute neighborhood, there is a small number of people without homes, set up a program and a breakfast program and a shower program for homeless people in their community. They involved the whole community to make that happen. And they made it happen in their community. And I think it's important to recognize all of the small businesses up and down Kingsway, who I get to represent, Honourable Speaker, who sometimes struggle with decisions of government. Witness the HST decision, which for many was very destabilizing for their business, but also contribute mightily to all that, are involved in volunteering in the community, support volunteering, support co-op programs, involve young people in their businesses, Honourable Speaker, who work together with the community. And small businesses along Kingsway working together in community consultation to deal with some of the most difficult problems in our community, problems of the sex trade in our community, and everybody is working on these problems together. It's an honor for me to be MLA for Vancouver Kingsway and to speak in this budget debate and to speak about what I think is important, that we not, as a community, I think as MLAs, it's at the core of what we need to do, which is to not sacrifice the future for the political present. And I'm afraid, Honourable Speaker, we have a budget that just does just that. And I think that's unfortunate. And I know that ministers of the Crown struggle with this. I know MLAs on the government side struggle with this. I think I have more understanding and empathy with that struggle than many members of the House. But I think they've missed here. I think there's different directions that we need to take the province in. And that's our job as an opposition, to offer those suggestions, to hold the government accountable, and I'll do some of that in the speech, but also offer suggestions. And to do that in a spirit of positive, I think, of the positive role and the positive contribution that an opposition can make. And I'll just give one example of that amongst many. When I came here as a member of the legislature in 2005, the honorable member for Victoria Beacon Hill named me the critic for children and families. And in that period, in that first year as critic, I worked with the late Stan Hagen, who was an honored member of this House. And we had a difficult debate sometimes, but we brought some changes to this House and changes to the child protection system that made real improvements for children. And that's what we have to do, just as health critic. When the government, I think, brought forward an ill-founded scheme on generic drugs that cost the province money, I made the case for change, and yesterday, the government acknowledged, I think, that what I had said was correct and the direction they had gone was wrong. And that's good opposition politics too. And by the way, That's good government politics. So where are we, Honorable Speaker? Where are we at this point in time? This is the budget tabled in 2012, and it's in a line, a successive line of budgets that I think have avoided dealing with the core issues of our province. In 2009, the government tabled a budget it said had a deficit of $475 million. 6 months after the premier of the day, and the most of the principal players in the government are still here, the premier of the day had gone on TV in response to an economic crisis. They said the deficit was $475 million. They were not only wrong, they said it 2 weeks before the election day, and they were dramatically wrong. They said that was the case, and clearly it wasn't the case. And that action, that, I think, it's fair to say, misleading interpretation of the government's finances, has dominated the government's agenda over the last number of years. So what happened after the election? They had said they weren't going to bring in the HST, then they brought it in. A direct result of the fact that they brought forward a budget that, frankly, did not accurately reflect the finances of the province. And nobody can say we didn't know the financial crisis was coming. It had started the previous year. Lehman Brothers had happened the previous year. And yet the premier had gone on TV the previous year to speak about it. And yet this is what we got. And this guided the province for the next number of years. In 2010, other than the HST, we had a budget that did not address the key economic issues of the province. In fact, the Olympic Games were going on, a celebration that both sides of the House had worked and contributed to bringing about. And it wasn't really, frankly, much of a budget at all. Then in 2011, because we were in the context of a leadership race on the government side, Honorable Speaker, it was a budget that didn't address any of the problems. It was just a stand-pat budget. So we've had a four-year mandate. In 2009-10, we had a budget that was solely, Honorable Speaker, dealing with the fact that they were completely inaccurate on the deficit side. In 2010-11, we had a stand-put budget, except for the HST, which they said they hadn't brought in. In 2011-12, we had a budget that made no changes, and so here we are in 2012 and 13. A government elected in 2009 that has essentially not dealt with the key issues facing the province in difficult times in that period. So what are those key issues? Because members of the House, and you know, Honorable Speaker, I've heard members of the House talk about Greece and other countries. Presumably from the previous member, it was celebrating the rule of Silvio Berlusconi, a right-wing politician in Italy, Honorable Speaker. For most of Greece's history, it has been dominated by the military, excessive and unpaid spending on military issues, and by right-wing political parties. That is the history of Greek politics. The presence of social democratic parties in Greece has been the exception. And when the member from Kelowna was there 6 years ago, there was a right-wing government like the Liberal Party in power. Right? So let's... So let's be serious here. Let's be serious here. There are serious problems in the world, and they deal with all of us, and they affect British Columbia. But let's not engage in that discussion in the spirit of name-calling, which is contrary to what is happening around the world. Let's understand that as the case. Understand that British Columbia, in many respects, is well situated to deal with some of those issues because of our geographic location and our history and our extraordinary people. I mean, you talk about a relationship with Asia, the relationship with Asia in my constituency, where a majority of my constituents are Chinese Canadian, where a huge percentage have come from Vietnam, have come from the Philippines. Our relationship with Asia and our relationship with the United States are key advantages. And that gives us an opportunity to build on those advantages if we do the right things here in British Columbia. So what are our core problems? Well, one of them is that our economy is clearly growing too slowly to sustain prosperity and to sustain the jobs of the future. And again, these debates and on the government side, and I think it's strange on the government side, become the subject of name-calling and negative television ads. The reality is that the economic growth record of this current government is the worst of any government in my lifetime. Now, what do we conclude from that? I mean, these are the facts. They were there in BC stats. What do we conclude from that? The BC Progress Board notes this on the key economic indicators. We've gone down and not up. And so the response, just as in forestry, where we no longer keep an inventory of our forest resources, the response is to get rid of the Progress Board. The reality is that over the last 10 years, we've gone down, not up. Now, is that all the government's fault? Of course not. Of course not. Is it the premier's fault that every quarter since she's become premier, more people have left the province to other provinces than have come here? Is that the premier's fault? No. Often, the individual actions are good actions. I met someone in Kelowna when I was there recently who's going to the University of Calgary. That's out-migration, but I think you would argue that's good out-migration in the sense that he is going to upgrade his skills. So let's stop the name-calling. We are not getting enough growth. And surely, Honorable Speaker, the key issues in that regard also include the growing inequality we're seeing in our province, which itself, I would argue, Honorable Speaker, is an impediment to growth. All of the evidence shows that more unequal societies, societies where there is not the capacity for social mobility, in other words, even if you're born a low-income people, if you live in a society that has social mobility, you can rise up, and that is an entrepreneurial force in every sense in the society. Right? What we are seeing in British Columbia, by any standard, by the Progress Board standards, by the Conference Board report standards, by the government's own standards, as published by BC Stats, which says, Honorable Speaker, that we have the worst disparities in incomes in the entire country. And this has economic consequences for us as well. And I think the third big issues, these are the big issues of our time. How do we sustain growth? How do we address issues of inequality that will, in the long term, impede our economic success and our societal success and cause division in our society? That's the second question. And the third question is, how do we sustain that with respect to our environment? These are key questions of our time. And I think it's in that context that we have to look at the budget, Honorable Speaker. I mean, the credibility, Honorable Speaker, unfortunately, as I said, of the government is low on their projections. $80 billion in contractual obligations going over. It went up $27 billion in 1 year. I think even the Berlusconi government would look at that. Honorable Speaker, I think even the Berlusconi government would consider that, you know, to follow the thinking and the logic of the members opposite. The most massive deficit mistake in BC history, Honorable Speaker. And you know, the Van der Zandt government was pretty good at that, Honorable Speaker, that they beat them, Honorable Speaker, before the last election. So what do we do in these times? It seems to me, Honorable Speaker, we have to get the fundamentals right. And it is not right. It does not make sense to do at its core what the government is doing. Having made these terrible mistakes around the time of the last election that not only hurt the people of BC, but hurt the government itself, disrupted the government itself. The deficit projection that led to the HST has led to chaos on the economic policy of the government. This is what has happened over the last number of years. It has not, I would argue, Honorable Speaker, been good for them. So what do they present us in this budget? A desperate effort to pretend there's a balanced budget in the year leading into a general election based on, get this, the short-term sale of assets that belong not only to the people of British Columbia, but their children and grandchildren. Now, Honorable Speaker, as you know, and I want to get this number right, I think I was off by $2 million the other day in the House. It's $706 million. The Minister of Finance says he come up with a number. It's $706 million. Apparently, they're going to keep selling till they get to that number. That's their strategy. That they can't tell us what properties they want to sell, except the Minister of Finance, because he's perhaps because he's an MLA from Surrey, gave us an idea, an inkling of what was going to happen in Surrey. But think of this. Think of Surrey over successive governments, Liberal, Social Credit, NDP governments. 1960 to 1970, they gained 5,000 people a year. 1970 to 1980, 10,000 people a year. 1980 to 90, 10,000 people a year. 1990 to 2000, 10,000 people a year, and 10,000 people a year under the current government. Why would you be selling the assets, the land assets of the government in Surrey? Why would that make any sense? Everything tells us that Surrey is going to continue to grow as a community and grow as importance. And they are selling assets now, and the Minister of Finance doing it because his surplus is only about $160 million in the election year, and he needs to sell $475 million in assets to get there. How does that make sense for our children, for the future citizens of Surrey? It does not make sense to sell out the future for the Liberal Party's present. But I think, Honourable Speaker, even more, and this is an important question, I think it's an important debate we have to have in this House, which is the debate around skills training. And it's a debate, interestingly enough, across the political spectrum, Honourable Speaker, across the political spectrum, there is consensus, which is that there's a skill shortage in the province. The Liberal government says that we're going to be short 61,500 skilled workers through this decade. 61,500. The BC Construction Association is looking for skilled workers in Ireland. Well, some people face long-term unemployment in our province, Honourable Speaker. Businesses are telling us that costs are going up because of the skills shortage. Honourable Speaker, there is a massive gap between the skills in the workforce today and the skills that they're going to need. The government's own statistics show that 80% of the jobs of the future will require some form of post-secondary education, Honourable Speaker. This is 34,000 of that, I think. 34% of that, I should say, Honourable Speaker, requires university-style education, 44% of it, other styles of education, from trades to training to apprenticeship. This is a key economic problem. Our prosperity depends on investing in the human capital of our workforce. And what does this budget do, Honourable Speaker? Does it listen to the Canadian Chamber of Commerce, which says that this is a key question, that the governments have to focus on skills training? Does it follow even the Drummond report, Honourable Speaker, in Ontario? Mr. Drummond offered lots of suggestions around cuts. It was generally viewed as a hard report on government. He said the one area of government that you don't cut for the future of your economy at a time of a skills shortage is skills training. That's what Mr. Drummond said. The BC Business Council said the same thing. The BC Federation of Labour said the same thing. There is a consensus out there of everybody on this question, save one. The area of government singled out for the largest cuts in this budget was the Ministry of Advanced Education, with skills training and apprenticeships. This seems to me, Honourable Speaker, to be a government that ultimately is giving up, Honourable Speaker, on the future. Why and how, when everyone recognizes, when the government, in the rhetoric of the jobs plan, and we know a lot about the rhetoric of the jobs plan because they spend a lot of money on advertising, Honourable Speaker, so we know a lot about the rhetoric of the jobs plan. They're spending $15 million on television ads advertising the jobs plan, and they're cutting spending for young people who would need to be trained to get the jobs of the future. Honourable Speaker, selling out the future for the present, for the Liberal Party's present. It's the wrong approach, Honourable Speaker, and it's why since the government came out of its jobs plan and before, we've given so much focus on this side of the house to positive suggestions on skills training. But it's not just us. It's community college and university college presidents who've made specific suggestions to the government in Prince George. School boards in Kamloops who made specific suggestions to the government, Honorable Speaker. Business leaders and labor leaders and community leaders who said skills training is everything. Aboriginal leaders. First Nations leaders have said the same thing. And the government comes forward with a budget in these economic times with this skills shortage that cuts the budget for skills training. Honorable Speaker, that is the wrong approach for our economy and the wrong approach for our province. Of course it's about choices. And of course it's about priorities, Honorable Speaker. But everybody, I think, would acknowledge that those are the wrong choices and the wrong priorities, Honorable Speaker. And then we move on to an area, I think, that was raised in this House with a report tabled, Honorable Speaker, in this House by the Auditor General around forest health. Now, there are, I don't need to tell anybody in this House that the last decade has been difficult times for our forest industry. In fact, the last several decades have been. Over the last decade, we've lost 35,000 jobs. Mills have gone down across the province. The value of our exports has declined, Honorable Speaker. It's been a difficult decade. But I think, Honorable Speaker, all of us would acknowledge that the forest industry remains a great force in our province, Honorable Speaker. And what it requires, A, and every time you talk to anybody in the forest industry, they'll tell you this, a commitment to training that this government doesn't have. And secondly, Honorable Speaker, if we are going to have in the future a forest industry that has sustained communities and sustained our economy as it has in the past, we have to have a commitment to forest health. And we cannot have a don't ask, don't tell policy towards forest health. The government does not know, Honorable Speaker. Not sufficiently restocked lands, Honorable Speaker. We have estimates from government agencies that say it's 2 million hectares, and we have government ministers saying it's 245,000 hectares, Honorable Speaker. It sounds like the 2009-10 budget, Honorable Speaker, in some respects. But Honorable Speaker, all of us, Honorable Speaker, if we're going to make the right decisions for the future at a crucial time in our forest industry, with all that has occurred, Honorable Speaker, we need to have the basis of fact in order to make the right decisions. Because some of those decisions, by definition, are going to be difficult decisions. So not knowing is not an option. And not knowing seems to be government policy. And that has been expressly indicated by the Auditor General in his report. And rather than accepting that and changing that, the government provides nothing in their budget to address it and denies the facts as laid out by the independent Auditor General, Honorable Speaker. So we have a government that in the first week of this session denied, essentially, the main findings of the independent ombudsperson's report on seniors care, denied the main findings of the independent Auditor General on forest health, denied the findings of the BC Utilities Commission about their mismanagement of BC Hydro, about their ultimate use of selling out the future for the past, the proliferation of deferral accounts at BC Hydro. Honorable Speaker, I think, Honorable Speaker, there is a legitimate difference of opinion about the direction of the province between the Liberal Party and the NDP. But I think we have to have that discussion, Honorable Speaker. Surely we have to have that discussion about how we improve productivity in our economy, about how we improve public services on the basis of understanding and facts and not ignorance, Honorable Speaker. And I think finally, Honorable Speaker, on the fundamentals, the key fundamentals of where government is going, I think the government has failed to show the required leadership. In 2006, in this period from 2006 on, in our justice system, you know, British Columbia has had lots of things. Public health care came much later in our history. The form of public education we had came later in our history. Public post-secondary education came later in our history. We've always had a justice system. And from 2006 to the present, the government has engaged in an unfortunate experiment. They have not engaged in any reforms in the system of any consequence, and they've been reducing the resources to the existing system. And they appear surprised that the consequence of not taking any action in reform and reducing the resources to the present system is longer wait times and the kind of stays of proceeding we're seeing. But these are key issues ultimately for the way we function and the confidence we have in our government. And we have to do better. I think on these key issues, Honorable Speaker, whether it's issues of health care, where the opportunity to save money on prescription drugs has been lost up to now, where the government has finally taken some steps to do that, but there are steps that are still missing. We are spending too much on prescription drugs, money that could otherwise be spent in our healthcare system, where we've missed the opportunity to promote prevention and primary care in a period when the Canada Health Transfer was higher, and now we've lost it, Honorable Speaker. This approach of the government of ultimately abandoning the future, Honorable Speaker, for the present has hurt us in all these areas, and we have to try and do better. So that's why we're going to continue to do what we've been doing as an official opposition. Last year, we made sure to raise the issues around community living in British Columbia, and we have pressed the government for action. We are going to continue to act on skills training and press the government for action, and we're going to continue to propose alternatives, Honorable Speaker, and say how we're going to pay for them. That is our approach as an opposition. That is the reason why we're opposing a budget that sells out the future for the Liberal present, Honorable Speaker. So in my case, and they seem to have been woken up on the other side of the House, they've sold out, Honorable Speaker, the future for the present. We are going to continue to argue for the future of our children. All members of the House came here, Honorable Speaker, to do that, to leave a better British Columbia, and the official opposition for their children, the official opposition is going to continue down that path. Thank you very much.